Welcome, everybody, to this webinar about Dataverse and what we will develop within Shock Task 5.2. And welcome, everybody. It's a little bit strange situation because I think from the organizers, everybody sitting at home and not at our offices, but probably a lot of you also sitting at home. So in this in these strange times, we try to work as much as possible. I have one thing to say, that my internet connection is not very good. So when I'm away, something technical happens, Laura will try to take over and I will try to get back. This webinar is a little bit also an experiment, because it's not a normal webinar in which you show a lot of things, but we also would like to have feedback. That's a little bit difficult because you only have access to the chat and not to the microphone. We try to have some kind of discussions. So people are typing questions in the chat. So you can use the chat box. We will copy these questions in a Google document. So we know what kind of questions you have during the webinar. So welcome, everybody. Let's introduce my colleagues. Laura, she is for this project, she's functional manager, but she's also functional manager for Dataverse NL. Slava, my other colleague, he's a lead developer in this project, but he also works a lot for other projects. Concerning Dataverse and also other technical projects at Dance. And myself, Marion Wittenberg, I'm a service manager of Dataverse NL, and I'm also account manager of our other technical system, and I'm task leader for task 5.2, in which we would like to develop something about some extra functionality for Dataverse NL for the European environment. Content of this presentation. I show you some background of Shock Task 5.2. I will tell you, because I sent out an questionnaire beforehand, and in that questionnaire I asked whether people know about Dataverse, and some of you don't know. So some of you know Dataverse and also already use Dataverse, but I have a little bit of background what is Dataverse. And then my colleague Slava and Laura will tell you something about quality and maturity of the software, about data previewers, about CESS and metadata and controlled vocabularies, and about translation using Weblate, translation of the user interface and the metadata. A little bit of background of Shock for those people who are not involved. I think a lot of you are involved in Shock, but Shock is a cluster, an S3 cluster project in which 47 partners try to develop all kinds of services for the social and humanities environment in Europe. Social sciences and humanities. Part of it will be technical services, but also a lot of training and trust kind of services. And within that project, we have one work package. That's work package 5, and within that work package is task 5.2, and that is called hosting and sharing data repositories. And the objective is to develop a research data repository service on the EOSC for social science and humanities institutions, for institutions that don't have such a facility at the moment. And our deliverable is that by the end of the project, we have a repository service running. It's not really a service at that moment, because a service is a project never can deliver a service. The service has to taken up by someone, by an ERIC or by another organization. But we will have, besides an acceptance service, we will have a report on the principles of governance and sustainability. Because yeah, it's not only the technical infrastructure you have to develop, but also you have to have ideas how this infrastructure will run and who is responsible for that and that kind of thing. So that will be after by the end of the project ready. And the reason I would like to have this meeting is to know what people in Europe or institutions in Europe would like to have. So what one of the things we are thinking about, we can deliver really a service running on the Google Cloud. And CESDA has an infrastructure for that, so we can deliver something that is running on the CESDA Cloud. But maybe people would like to have more control and would like to run it on their own server. So therefore is this this webinar. The next slide is a little bit of background. What we do, we make use of data-first software. There were a couple of CESDA service providers who said, no, we have to start from scratch. But yeah, our idea was that there is already software there. That software is very good, is used by a lot of people. Why not make use of this software and look at this whether it would be possible to make this applicable or compliant to DARIA, CLERN, ERIS, and CESDA requirements. And that's the way we are working. So we try to build a mature infrastructure, but we also would like to have a look at your requirements. And so besides, we will work later on the governance model, and we will train service providers and institutes how to use data first. These are the partners. It's not only CESDA. So from CESDA, it's DANS and AUSDAR who are involved. From DARIA EU, there are Polish people and German, the University of Göttingen involved. From CLERN, there is the University of Tromsø. And we just had in January, we had a big European data first community meeting there. And from ERIS, there is the Italian partners. So we are working together. What I did was a Dataverse webinar is for CESDA or CESDA-related organizations, because I think I would like to discuss with the different ERICs separately what their requirements are, because otherwise you get discussions about metadata models and what is the most proper appropriate model. But I think we would like to develop something that is as useful for CESDA, as useful for DARIA, for CLERN, and for ERIS as well. A little bit of background of this task. So this, we don't start from scratch. There were already two other projects. First was the CESDA SOAR project, strengthening and widening. And in that project, we offered a test environment for to run experiments. So a couple of CESDA service providers together. I can remember that Tarki and ADP were involved. So yeah, we tried to look whether this would suit their needs. And then we had another project, the CESDA Dataverse AU project. It was only 1 year, and it was a kind of proof of concept, how to make data for CESDA compliant. And there were involved DANS, AUSDA, ADP, the Swedish Data Archive, Tarki, and GACES. So why this webinar? We would like to demonstrate our work, and we would like to discuss with you ideas on the Dataverse installation. Would you like to have it on your own technical environment, or would you like CESDA to have some kind of central service running so that every service provider could make use of that? And what kind of extra functionality would you like to have? And that's a little bit difficult to answer for people who have no clue about Dataverse, but we'll try to show you something. And in this webinar, there's enough time to discuss and come back. And so this is not only one webinar. It's a kind of way to start the discussion. And we also have in this webinar a little bit information on how to perform the translations and information on metadata and controlled vocabularies. And what is Dataverse? And I think Dataverse is a repository software for sharing and publishing data. And it's what you do, what you publish is metadata and files. And it is a little bit different than Nestor. than Nestor. A lot of you uses Nestor. And in Nestor, you not only publish metadata, but you also publish metadata on a higher level, on study level, but you also publish metadata on variables and question wordings. And that's different in Dataverse. It's metadata and files. Survey data, it's all kinds of file. Are you hearing me?
Yes, please continue. Okay.
Because there was a red sign, I'm sorry. So in Nestor, Nestor is used for survey data, but here you can publish all kinds of data. It's open source software developed by IQSS, and that's nice because if it's open source, you can develop yourself also. And but what we do, we develop within this project and another project, we develop extra functionality, but we will push this back to Harvard. So Harvard will review it and take it over in their own master branch. But because otherwise you are responsible for their own fork and a lot of trouble. But maybe Slava will tell you something about it. So there are a lot of organizations that contribute to... are you still hearing me? I'm sorry. Are you...
Yes.
Oh, sorry. There is a lot of or other organizations in the world at the moment. There are 55 Dataverse services, and you will get the slides afterwards, so you can click on those links. So there is a Dataverse service in the Netherlands. There's a Dataverse service in Austria. There's a Dataverse service at Harvard. There's a Dataverse service at the Odum Institute in the USA, in Australia, and Canada. So we are not the only one who thinks that Dataverse is a very good repository service. I can't go. The problem, I can't. Yeah. I'm sorry. I have technical problems, but I hope I don't disturb you. So this is an example of, for the people who never have seen Dataverse, this is an example of Dataverse NL. So in which we give access in the Netherlands to all kinds of universities. So and this is the interface of the service. So you see the University of Utrecht, the University of Maastricht, Tilburg, University of Groningen. And this is a data set. So yeah, it's different to compare to Nestor. Here you see, I'm not sure whether you see very clearly, but here is a DOI. There is an information how to cite the data. There is metadata. There are terms on how to use the data. There it's possible to have versions. Here you have data files, and if you see, you can have a request action button, access button, so people can request access, send an email via the system to the owner of the data set. And what is a nice feature of Dataverse that there are a lot of roles and permissions available. So you can have permissions for data managers, and you can have permissions for end users, and you can have permissions for depositors. So, and there is a whole system in which you can give different permissions to different users. And I think this is very good developed. I go one slide back. I don't. Oh yeah, and I'm not sure whether this is. So if you would like to play with Dataverse, you can use this demo Dataverse, and so you can see, you can add data, you can add Dataverses, and this is where here we. Made it possible for everyone to do that. So the user permission for a production Dataverse are usually much more restrictive. But in this Dataverse, you can just play around, look around, and have a look and feel. And there was one question in the questionnaire: what is the difference between a Dataverse and a data set? I go a little bit back. So a Dataverse is a folder. So we have a folder for the University of Utrecht, University of Maastricht, and under that folder there can be other folders. So a Dataverse is just like a folder on your computer, and by the end there is a data set, and a data set is a package where there is metadata and files together. You can also have some kind of metadata Dataverse level, but just see the Dataverse as a folder. So the main difference, because there was a question about why using Dataverse and not other repositories. So you have Figshare, but the problem is that Figshare is commercial and this is open source. So we can adjust Dataverse to our own needs, and with Figshare we have to pay for it. We will send you a document afterwards with the answers to all your questions. And there was also a comparison between different software for different repositories, and Dataverse was had a very good score. But I think for most of you the main difference would be to compare to Nestar, and that's very different because Dataverse is suitable for all kinds of data, not only server data, but it's not really suitable for publishing survey data in a very granular way. So if you would like to publish the variables and the question wordings, it's at the moment it's only possible to do that in files and not in the user interface like in Nestar. But there are a lot of nice features that aren't part of Nestar. So it has a persistent identifier. It's possible to have a persistent identifier on study level and also on file level. Dataverse can keep track of the versions of the data set. It's possible to use federated login so that people can change their credentials of their university or their research institute. And what I already said, Dataverse has a variety of user permissions. And there are a lot of other things that really are very nice to have. I think I stop here because I know that we can discuss much longer about this, but maybe there are questions. I have a problem because I have to log in my other system, but just a moment. I'm there. There are no questions in the chat box. So then I give the floor to my colleague Slava, who will say you something about our development and about the maturity of the software we develop. Slava, go ahead.
Hello everyone. So now I will continue with introduction of functionality we are developing in Dataverse Shock project. And before actually I will start, I want to introduce a model called CESDA maturity model. And this is our basic model for all services that we want to run in European Open Science Cloud. So if you'll see this nice chart from right side, it has 9 levels of maturity. And basically, all software that you are developing, you can evaluate and you can put in some box in this chart. So to be accepted as a service, it requires to have at least level 8 of maturity. And it means that all software should be not only sustainable, but it should be also supplied with all tests, and all people should be able to evaluate it in a transparent way. And also after this evaluation will be done, it should go through a continuous integration and development pipeline. So everybody should be able to reproduce and to reinstall the same services in own place. And of course, if there is some software that doesn't have any warranty anymore, we should be able to stop it. So for example, for Dataverse, we are developing software that will be not maintained probably anymore, so we can disconnect it anytime. And now we will talk a little bit about maturity, what it means. So every, like already said, every software package should follow this CESDA maturity model, which is very strict model, and basically it was copied from NASA maturity model. And it means that every software should have Kubernetes infrastructure deployed on the cloud with upstream Docker images, and it should be warranty statement, it should be clear documentation, all unit tests and Selenium tests should be created to test it, to be able to test software both on backend and frontend levels, and Jenkins pipeline should be available to deploy it in continuous integration pipeline. So it means also that all components should be reusable. And for example, after we'll deploy previewers that I will introduce in further slides, everybody should be able to connect own Dataverse instance to these previewers and to test this own Dataverse. So what we are going to do in this project? First of all, we are working on WebLate, which is a tool that allows to create multilingual translations. It's not available yet, but we're expecting it will be ready in September of 2020. And also we are going to concentrate on interoperability, and we are working on external control vocabulary support. And we are working closely with people from CESDA and GASIS to implement this functionality. And it will be available in December of 2020, according to our plan. And of course, data previews, which is very interesting for a lot of archives. So we have DD Explorer on roadmap, and spreadsheet viewer, PDF, text, HTML, images, video render, audio players, and other things like JS players. So this functionality is planned for June 2021, available in CESDA Cloud, and data processing tool. So basically, we are working on a pipeline that will allow to turn Nestor DTI files to Dataverse. And I will start from Nestor. So this pipeline, and we already have a demo implementation of this software. So what we can do, we can just export XML files from Nestor instances that you already have, probably, and to put FN in Dataverse, and all metadata from study level of DDI will go to metadata from Dataverse, and all variable level will go to files. So after we can connect DDI previewers, and basically you can see what you have in your DDI files, you can browse, you can visualize, you can do a lot of interesting things. And if you're interested, there is a link you can click and you can see, and you can get impression how actually it can be used. And we already started with some we started some experiments, and we reused this pipeline. For example, at Dance, we did manage to create pipeline that can convert data and metadata from easy from our system to Dataverse. This is just experiment, but it means that it's already reusable and you can start to use it also now. So now I'm going to talk about previewers, and basically all previewers are maintained by a global Dataverse community consortium, GDCC, and most of them developed by QDR in United States. But we are also contributing previewers, and we created spreadsheet viewer for tabular data. I will show you some interesting screenshots. And DDI Explorer was developed in Canada by Scholars Portal, and we did integration in Kubernetes to be able to deploy it on SESDA Cloud. And now there are available previewers already, and you can see there is also Stata preview, which is quite interesting functionality for DDI community, I think. And what you should understand, all previewers are available for open access data. It means that if you have some restricted data in your repository, you should be logged in to be able to view your data. It will not show up in other case. So this is a small example, and it's PDF previewer that already integrated in our system. And from left side, you can see a result. If you'll click on file in Dataverse, it will just show preview box. And there is some PDF from archaeology, and you can scroll down. You can also go through different pages. And from right side, there's a widget, because probably some people want to put some information in the repository, some PDF or images, and publish on own website. So there is possibility to copy paste some JavaScript lines, and it will be published externally, like YouTube widget or SlideShare, wherever. So next example is spreadsheet view previewer. This is our contribution to Dataverse community, and you have a lot of interesting things in this solution. You can sort all rows and columns by values. You can select and copy paste from here. But what you should understand, it's not directly connected to Dataverse. So you can change values here, but it will be not stored in Dataverse. It's something different. It's a different solution. It's not like Google Drive, Google Documents. Another example is image previewer. And this is very nice, for example, in our case. So there is a possibility to go through different images, and without download, you can see different collections. You can see a lot of images, and it's very nice. You can try it also. And if you have some questions, you can just put in chat box.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions, so I start with the questions. Veerle from the UKDS would like to know how secure would be a Dataverse set up on the EOS Cloud be? Slava, can you answer that?
So basically what we do, we're developing infrastructure that runs in the cloud in a secure way. So it's, of course, it's not developed for storing of sensitive data yet. So we don't have an encryption and two-factor authentication, but for public files, you can use it, and because everything is in one infrastructure, and Kubernetes is responsible for security. Application itself is used by 50 and something institutions. So we are sometimes where we see some security issues, but it's highest priority for Harvard as well to fix all these issues. So I think there are not a lot of security issues at the moment, but if you'll find something, you can send it to us, and we will try to fix it as soon as possible. But for now, there are no issues like that.
Yeah, but I think to be sure that it's not possible to use Dataverse at the moment for very sensitive data. It's only possible to use it for public use files or for anonymized or also for pseudonymized data, but not for privacy sensitive data. The next question I will answer myself. That's from Jenny from ISDA from Ireland, and she would like to know the pros and cons of having an own installation versus Dataverse in the CESDA cloud. The difference is that on a Google Cloud, you only have one folder in your system, and we have to look whether what kind of possibilities are there to really adjust it to the needs of the different institutions. So we don't know yet, but it would be possible that we can adjust the persist identifier for that the people from Ireland would like to use an Irish DOI, and that from Austria would like to use an Austrian DOI, and from AP would like to use an Slovenian URN, but that's not sure at the moment. So making use of a cloud solution, then yeah, there should be some common functionality that has to be used by everyone. What we are thinking about is that at the same time as we developing a cloud solution, we can make an image of that, and that image can be downloaded as a kind of archive in a box, and that can then be put on your own system, and there you can adjust it to your own needs. And so then you can, it's easily to adjust it. So translate user interface, do your own things, but that's also depending on the level of staff and the amount of staff you have. Some people don't have technical staff at all, and they are happy to use a central service. Other people have enough staff, and then they can download the CESDA made Dataverse and install it on their own service. And it's also possible, of course, to use the Harvard service, but that's not a thing. Then Veerle, can you explain the user restriction option more? Also, such plans developments made for level of permissions. I think at the moment we do not do anything on the user restriction. So there are a lot of user restrictions. So it's the metadata is always open, but the files can be restricted, and there is possible to have a restriction button. I know that Harvard is working on some aspects, but in the SHOC project we are not. Maybe Slaven doesn't a little bit know about it.
No, I don't think so.
No.
No.
And Jenny, I'm also interested in access control options. That's I think the same question. So there are possibilities to give access to other researchers or other users without publishing the data set. There are options to restrict the files. And there are options to have an access button to the files, but at the moment we are not working on to change functionalities.
Can I add something to that, Marion?
Yeah.
Because you also have the option, if your dataset is not published yet, to use a private URL, and that you can share your dataset while it's not published yet with your colleagues, and you can also give access to other accounts just manually, so you can do that on an individual level as well. So
Yeah, I think this webinar is a little bit complicated because there are a very different level of questions. So please come back to us when you have specific questions. And we will also have a webinar later on with its instructions. So really to use the system. Then there was a question from Christina from Force about long-term preservations are filed. And then the second, are files stored in long-term preservation formats? That's up to you. So what Dataverse does is only the technical system. So there are they check whether the files are not corrupt, and there's a fire scanner, but it's not. The file format, it's up to the data manager. So if someone is publishing a strange file format, what isn't sustainable, it will be there sustainable. Dataverse itself won't change the file format, but the technical infrastructure is very sustainable. So it's not possible because you publish it a persist identifier. It's not possible to remove a data set because there will be always a thumbstone that with the persist identifier and the reason. Or the new place where the data is. So the system itself is sustainable, but the file formats, that's up to you. Then Jenny from Ireland. This may be a simplistic question. How does Dataverse user interface integrate it into an existing new website for an archive? Maybe Laura, you can answer this. Or would I do that? Or
I'm not sure what's meant here, but if you have an existing archive, I'm not sure if it's meant that you want to migrate your data, or if you have a website, a standalone website. I'm not sure what this question is about, but with Dataverse, you can make your own homepage. And so you can have your own website in front of it, but that's something else than migrating all of your data into Dataverse, of course. So, maybe if you want to know more or explain more, you can send the question in an email or something. Maybe that's better.
Well, I also can add, as I understand it, if there is possibility to integrate Dataverse user interface in on website, so if the question about widget, you can just create this widget directly from Dataverse and copy paste a few lines of code in your website, and it will just appear on your website in your web interface.
Jenny, if this isn't the right answer, please do a, oh, there was a term from Jenny. So, and then another question. Jenny, have access statistics? Yes, that's possible. Maybe Laura, you can tell a little bit about it.
There are in the Dataverse code. There is it's possible to collect the user statistics, and maybe. It's nice to know that for Dataverse NL, we made more API endpoints to be able to measure the statistics also on Dataverse level and not for the Dataverse instance as a whole. So there is a lot of stuff that can be used. And Harvard is also busy with expanding all kind of metrics. So yes, it's possible.
And I can add, if you would like to try it, you can download Miniverse. It's a Python application that you can be connected to Dataverse. And you can see everything on charts, visually attractive. And you can scroll through all sub-Dataverses. And you can basically get all uses statistics. So it's a solution from Harvard itself.
Then Then the next question is from Veronica about the PDF viewer. What impact do file restrictions have? So is it only possible for unrestricted files? Noah?
Currently that is the case, but I think there might be some developments going on, because it was, I think, possible to have a previewer, but then you have to use your API token, and that's not for everyone a good solution, but maybe there will be a solution soon for that. Maybe Slava knows more about that.
Yeah, so for now, there's possibility only to see public files, and if you want to see restricted files, you should be logged in and you should have right permissions actually to download file. This is necessary condition to see preview button.
A question from Iris, not from CESDA, but for the University of Göttingen. The question by Veronica would also relate to other data previewers, for example, the spreadsheet viewer. There might be concerns about accessing viewing restricted data.
Okay, so it's the same functionality, and basically all these previewers are external applications. It's HTML plus JavaScript. So basically it runs in your browser, and there are no different permissions. It's just exactly the same implementation. It means that if you have a restricted image, you should be able to open this image and to see preview only if you have permissions to open file this image.
So what I do, there are more questions, but I would like to go further with the presentation and answer these questions after the next presentation. Okay. And the next, this is
my slide. Slava talked about previewers and about the Nestar tool. But another point for the 5.2 task is to configure data first for CESDA, and then especially we would like to offer the CESDA metadata fields. There's already been some work in the Dataverse EU project for this. We made a comparison between the standard metadata fields and the CESDA metadata model. Dataverse is using a citation block. The most basic fields are based on DDR 2.2. I looked it up. Not many changes are needed for that. There's probably one or two fields that need some minor adjustments. But this is what we want to do in the SHOCK project. We have the CMM also available in Dataverse. What needs some more effort are the controlled vocabularies. We want to connect Dataverse with the controlled vocabularies that are important for CESDA. In the Dataverse EU project, again in 2018, we already started with working on that. A plugin was made, developed by Dance, and it was this plugin, it can be connected to API. So if a controlled vocabulary is exposed with an API endpoint, with this plugin you can connect to that, so you can make use of this controlled vocabulary within Dataverse. We made a prototype then, and it was not tested really good, and it was not production ready. But for SHOCK, we would like to work on this further and to have this production ready. Let me explain a bit more about how this works, because this is the current situation. I hope it's big enough to see. This is an example of a metadata field from Dataverse where you can use a controlled vocabulary. So you have three subfields, term, vocabulary, and the URL. But right now the problem is that these fields are all free text. So if a user would like to use this field, well, he has to be aware that a controlled vocabulary can be used. So he has to know about controlled vocabularies. And even if he does, then he has to put in the term in himself. And well, of course, you can have mistakes like spelling mistakes or using capitals or that kind of stuff. So what would be nice is to have a more user-friendly approach. So for certain fields, we would like to connect with the controlled vocabularies. The desired situation is that the user will type in a term, and with the help of autocomplete, the term from a topic from a classification will pop up. So the other two fields are then filled in automatically. So we made a mapping. This was also done in the Dataverse EU project, this mapping, that for to see which Dataverse metadata fields can be connected with which controlled vocabulary. So you see here the example in my slide before this one. The topic classification, it should be connected to the CESTA topic classifications. So we made already this this mapping. We have we have worked on it, and it's not perfect yet, but we have a good start. So we try to test this and get it in production. Let me see. Well, this plugin is also generic, so it can. It's not only for the CESTA vocabularies, but if you have any other vocabulary you want to expose in Dataverse, you can connect with it if it has an API endpoint. And I'll let Slava talk about the CESTA API now. So.
Okay, just to a little bit to elaborate. So to be connected to Dataverse, you need to use OpenAPI, and on next slide, you can actually see implementation from CESDA. So CESDA control vocabulary service was developed by GASIS, but maintained by CESDA itself on Kubernetes. And it has multilingual support, so you can use language as parameter to query this API endpoint. Also it shows different versions of control vocabularies. So if your control vocabulary will be extended with new terms, it will get new version and you can query this version, but also a previous version. And it has Elasticsearch syntax. So it's quite flexible and you can get much more information from this index. So actually, if you have your own control vocabulary, you can contact CESDA metadata office and they can actually extend CESDA CV vocabulary service with your terms, and after it will be automatically connected to Dataverse. And just to give you example how it works, so I have two small examples here. First, if you'll search, for example, for household family, and you will create a triple with term itself and your right to control vocabulary, to term and URL to control vocabulary, you can search in French after you will switch to French language in Dataverse. And if you'll search for famille ménage, it will be still linked to the same entity. And after some time, it can go to knowledge graph and people can actually find all things, even searching in own languages. They'll be able to find, in this case, a household family. So it's really language dependent, and in a way, it's a possibility to build this knowledge graph, and after some time, people can easily find information, and researchers can also use data from other countries for their own research. So if you have some questions, you can put in chat again about this functionality.
So there are a lot of questions. So we start over again where we were. So the next question is from Benjamin from Soda from Belgium. As Dataverse administrators, do you often get emails from researchers about access to this or that dataset, but they should have contacted the authors directly, or you must redirect them? So I think that's a very nice feature of Dataverse, that it is possible to adjust it to your own needs. So if you would like the researchers to answer, then you can do that, or if you would like to have the administrator answer it, that would, both ways are possible. So you can have all kinds of permissions and rights and roles to a Dataverse and also to a data set. So also this access handling is also possible to do that. The only thing is that because you never know when a researcher will answer the request, it also would be good to have it in a little bit in control yourself. It's possible to have both permissions, or more than one person with permissions and roles to a data set or Dataverse. Then a question of Benjamin, how do you manage requests for embargoes? I think that has nothing to do with the technical system. That's something in your own workflow. So yeah, it's a manual thing, and that should be part of your data management procedures. Then a question of Alina from SciencePo. Concerning Veronica and Iris questions, I would have an additional one. Do you think a certain point of quantitative data would we could develop a variable search functionality? At the moment, if the data are the variables and the question wordings are in the files, then you can search on it. But maybe Slava can tell a little bit more about it. But if you only have, it's quite different than Nestor. It's not document the variables and so there's not a possibility to document variables and so Nestor had, I can't remember the name, but Nestor had also the possibility to make a Nestor file, and that's something that's not that is not any functionality in Dataverse is compared to that. But maybe okay. Slava can say something about the searchable of variables.
Yeah, so basically with our solution that we developed to migrate DDI to Dataverse, it's possible to search inside of variables stored in the files if you will enable full text index from Dataverse developed by QDR in the United States. There is external functionality, and I think it's described nicely in manual. So by default, it's disabled. It's not possible to search inside of files, but after you will enable, it will be possible actually. So if you have some questions, please contact me, and I will send you links how to do that.
And maybe I can, we have to think about it because I know that a lot of people would like to have a same kind of system as Nestor, but this is a different system. So so I think when you really would like to have a Nestor kind of system, I never have seen the system myself, but I think that's a system like produced by Collectica in the United States would be a better solution if you only have survey data and you only would like to publish survey data and have no other data. But I don't know whether this service also have the possibility to publish, to have a DOI and that kind of persistent identifier features. That I don't know. I will give you the address later on. Slava, is it possible to search inside variables if you enable full text search? Oh, Irena, can we answer this? I don't know what you mean by that. That's something. Benjamin asked, if Slava could write down the name of the application for statistics that Slava mentioned. Yeah, we will put this in the information and will be sent later on. Or Slava, maybe you can already put it in the chat yourself. The link to the application for statistics. But
I will just write down Miniverse and you can Google on it.
Yeah. Then the next question from John from Ireland. Two observations for comment. A hosted solution assumes that a help desk and a server level agreement be put into place. Will this be part of the planning through 2020? Yes. If people would like to have a central service, what the idea is that we write a report how to set up such a service, and then CESTA has to decide whether they would like to have to run their service their own, or that they outsource this service to one of the CESTA service providers. But for a production server it's very important that there is a service level agreement, that there are contracts, that there are processor agreements. So this whole kind of bundle of more policy documents and policy decisions should be part of the technical solution, but only when people would like to use such a service. The other possibility would be that you would like to would have your own service. Then we also publish, then we make a kind of, what I said before, an archive in a box. So the developments are the same, but we don't run our a production server, or there won't be a production service for CESTA, but there would be a kind of archive in a box solution. People can download our development and install them on their own technical infrastructure. The second question of John is, data producers will presumably have concerns about their data being hosted in the cloud internationally by a third party. Will this be explored as part of the SHOC project? Yes. That is already a little bit my answer. So we really need to know whether people would like to have such a service. And there is also a possibility that the data are somewhere else. Maybe Slava, you can tell a little bit about this.
Yeah, so there is nice functionality that contributed by Global Dataverse Consortium. So basically you can, in next release, you can choose where you want to put your data. And according to Harvard, it will be released probably next week or in 2 weeks. And we will test and we will see if it really works like they're describing now.
Yeah. So, but to answer your question, John. Yeah, we really would be part of this project to investigate whether service providers would like this and what kind of policy documents should be there to make this a secure service. Then the next question is from Benjamin from Belgium. Your work on controlled vocabularies will likely be very useful for all of us. One question for custom CVs, for example, could it be possible to include an other option that lets users enter free texts in case some possibilities were not anticipated?
Maybe. So basically, we are not changing functionality, so you can put free text if you want. Just possibility to search through all available variables, but if you don't like, you will just remove it and you can put whatever you want in this block. So I don't see any problems.
Yeah, and to be sure, what we will develop will be tested. So therefore, I asked in my questionnaire who would be interested to test our functionality, because from a technical point of view, sometimes it works. From a user end of user perspective, sometimes it doesn't work completely as you would like to have it. So we really start testing after we have implemented this functionality at the SESTA Cloud. Then a question from I hope I pronounced your name correctly, Drazenko from a Croatian data provider. If we need to add some custom metadata elements, is it done by configuration or by programming?
I can answer. So basically, the way how the Dataverse team does that now, there is a file in Google spreadsheet, and probably we can share a link afterwards. So all fields actually in already in this file, and you can modify, you can create your own copy, and after you can download as TSV element and use API to change metadata elements. So it's not necessary actually to change something in source code.
Then the next question is from Ariana from France. Why should we implement Dataverse instead of other open source solution like NADA? What are the advantages of Dataverse? I don't know NADA. Slava, do you know NADA?
Well, there are a lot of systems. So I think at the moment there are thousands of open source repositories available, even open source. But the question, if you want to create actually FAIR compliant data repository and provide this as a service to your researchers, you should follow FAIR principles. And according to latest evaluation, Dataverse scores the highest. And we also will put link. You can see this research and evaluation, and you can make decision if Dataverse is something for you.
Yeah, so if you would like to implement something else, that's up to you. What we thought, because we had a lot of knowledge to using Dataverse for ourselves, so therefore we thought that would be something useful for the SESTA community. So we started with it in the SESTA SOAP project, and later on in a SESTA work plan project. And yeah, we saw that people were enthusiastic, or there were things that should be improved, but therefore we have now a shock project. But if someone who would like to use another system, yeah, that's fine. It's not mandatory for SESTA service providers to use Dataverse. It's just something we could offer to them. Then I think the last question until now is from Tolis from Eke from Greece. So the question is, so to be compliant with SESTA CMM, we only have to care about CVs. Are all the DDI 2.5 mandatory recommended fields included in Dataverse? Maybe Laura, you can answer this question.
Yes. Well, there are some issues to be solved, because I think translated title is missing. And also in the subject fields, there needs to be some alterations, but it's not that much work. But we should, there are some fields that are in other metadata blocks. For example, I'm not sure, unit of analysis or that kind of stuff. It's in the social sciences and humanities metadata block, so you need to configure it. It's not really programming, but you need to configure it so that it's a mandatory field instead of an optional field. So the fields are available in Dataverse, but you need to configure it in a way that it's mandatory for your Dataverse.
So and we will do is that we will in discussion with you, we will make it possible. We give instructions how to make it mandatory and to how to make it as user friendly as possible. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this were the questions, I think, at the moment. So we continue with the presentation. We have 25 minutes left. So I think, I don't know, Slava or?
I will be telling you about WebLate. because WebLate, well, let me tell first about the Dataverse EU project, because there we also focused on localization. A lot of translations of the user interface were made during that project. But when we were busy with doing that, another release of Dataverse was out. And we had some problems because suddenly some new lines appeared or some properties that weren't translated. And it was very difficult to keep track because what was now translated already and what wasn't. And also we found out that for the user interface, there was a separate file, but we also needed to translate the metadata schema. And those translations were also somewhere else in the system. And we needed the translation of the solar search facet. So yeah, that was difficult because we needed to keep an eye on what was done and what wasn't. And the solution for that is probably using WebLate. It's a tool for translators, so they can have easy access to the strings that need to be translated and to keep it all up to date. It's now in an experimental phase. It's in the shock pipeline that we're developing. And what this tool does, it is attached or connected to a GitHub repository. And the translations made during the Dataverse EU project are also in GitHub in a separate repository. So we can connect to that. Let me go to... well, this is a short introduction, but the WebLate, you can give permissions and an account. So everyone who wants to be involved can elaborate on the or collaborate. If there's a new Dataverse version available, what it does, this new version will also have the files in a separate GitHub. WebLate will see those files and it will make clear in the user interface which strings are not ready yet. So what's missing is clear from WebLate. And when all the translations are ready and approved and everything is fine and saved, then all these translations are synchronized. So for each Dataverse version, you will have a file within GitHub that you can use. So we hope this using this tool that we will solve the problems we had in the previous project. So we can keep track of everything. And I think Slava will now demonstrate a bit how it works. And he also made some extra plugin for this. So.
Okay, so this is basically our demo. And it's not production ready yet because, as I already told you, we should follow SESDA maturity model. It means that we should put WebLate in SESDA Cloud and we should create all tests. We should make it really sustainable. But it's already available for public. And here you can see the link, weblate.dataverse.org. It's for demonstration purposes, it's enough. So what you can see from this screenshot, WebLate allows to import current versions of translations. And I don't know if it's big enough, but you can get clear overview of all languages about completeness. And in this screenshot, you can see some languages that some translations that were created some time ago in CESDA SO project. It was probably one year and a half ago. So you can see it's not complete. It's like 66 or 70%. But for versions of translations that maintain properly, like Canadian one, there is 99%. And I'll explain you why, because sometimes people that think that all properties translated, but actually according to WebLate, there is like one property is missing still. So it's not really consistent. So you can see from this overview what is current situation and what kind of work you should do to get everything complete. So the idea that every language will get own contributor, and after clicking on own language, I decided to go for French. It will open this web interface, and here you can see overview with statistics about things that should be done, and also you can get some information about persons that should be translated. So all this information is quite useful, and you from this interface you can directly go by clicking on strings that needed action. You can go to assignments, and it will show you this nice overview of all properties, and it will directly go through missing properties. So I don't know if it's big enough, but it has a few elements that you should know. From left side, you can see original property in English, and there is also context from right side in the middle. So this is how it's called in bundle properties file. And also from very right side, you can see there is possibility to attach screenshots. And it's very useful because in a lot of cases, people don't know how it should be translated without seeing it on the screen. So WebLate actually allows to create screenshot and exchange between translators. So they can see in which context and how it's actually it should be showed on the screen. So you can put right translation in WebLate. And after you will do all this work, you can go through all fields, all properties, and everything will be translated. So it will show this nice interface, this information, where actually to put all translations. So in our case, because we are operating this Global DataWorks Consortium repository, so it's possible to put all translated properties there automatically, because WebLate can synchronize. After clicking button by administrator, everything will go through this repository. But also, even now, without having an account, you can download all files with translations, and you can put it, even without GitHub, you can put it in your own Dataverse. So basically, after you're ready, there is a workflow that we are developing. And this GitHub repository containing, in this case, version 4.19, which is latest one. But after new release will come, we will create a copy from develop branch, and it will go to WebLate, and people will do translations. And after everything is ready, 100%, a new branch will be created in this repository called Dataverse minus V4.20. And this branch actually will be synchronized with WebLate, and also translations will go here. So it will allow actually to keep all these translations synchronized and up to date. Cool. Questions?
At the moment, I don't see any extra questions in that box. So what I can do is that we go to the questions. So when there are no other questions concerning WebLate, let me explain that we can't do all the translation ourselves because we are not native speakers. So if you would like to use Dataverse, and if you would like to use that, doesn't whether it would be a central service or a service for yourself, you can translate it in your own language or the language you like to use for your Dataverse. It's possible to have those to have a multilingual servers running on the Google Cloud. So then every organization can have their own languages. For some organizations, although they speak another language, they use English for in a research context, like we do at Dance. We have an English user interface. So for our own purposes, we don't translate, but we will use WebLate. Laura will translate everything in Dutch, so she knows the hurdles and what should be improved. But if you would like to use Dataverse on your own system or on the Google Cloud in your own language, yeah, you have to translate it yourself because we don't. Yeah, we speak a little bit French, but not enough to do the translations properly. And from Irina, can you say more in multilingual interfaces, please? So there will be a multilingual interface, or there will be a button to switch between the multilingual interfaces, between the different interfaces. So if you would like to have a French interface, then you can choose the French interface, but then there has to be a French translation. And it's not the case that if people will add metadata and choose for the English, then this won't be changed. So it's only the interface and the fields and the solar, so the facets to search on, that can be translated. But what the users or the data managers will put into the fields itself, that won't be translated because that's up to them. And if you would like to translate it, then you should change the content.
And I would like to add, if you want to add some custom fields, there's possibility to create component in WebLate and you can actually translate it to your own language. It's also part of this workflow. Yeah. And after, it will go to Global Dataverse Consortium repository.
And maybe to explain to everyone what is important, that it looks like that everything going to the Global Consortium Dataverse Consortium meeting, Global Dataverse Consortium community, isn't it? Something like that. Now, but that we do nothing. No, that is because it's open software. We work together. So the multilingual interface we developed during the CESDA Work Plan 2018 project, and we delivered it to Harvard. And then Harvard reviewed it and took it over and put it in our own branch. So that's the way we would like to develop, because if you only develop things for your own, you're making your own fork, as it's called. So then you are moving away from what is Harvard is developing. So at the same time, we now putting Dataverse in on the Google Cloud and have that Kubernetes infrastructure. So we do work for that, but at the same time, there are colleagues from a German organization outside of SHOC who also work on that. So it's really a collaboration. A global collaboration, and we try to have SHOC as much as possible So for all the work, we would like to have the credits. That's but so that we mentioned that this is done by Shock, and also Harvard does that. So our partners within this task developed the spreadsheet viewer, and then Harvard says Harvard took this code and it became part of the Harvard code, but so now it's not visible for users anymore that this was produced in Shock. But that's the way an open source community works. So we really work together, but Harvard thinks it's very important also to have this multilinguality, because before this was something. Yeah, they are in America, so why should they speak French, or why should they speak German? But now they are aware that this for the European community, it's very important to have this multilinguality. So they took over our code and put it in the French. Another question from Alina is, from what I remember, we worked with the Canadian team on the translation of the interface. My colleague Valentine did it, but I'm not sure where and when this translation was published. Yeah, we don't know, but what is important that is that in French of Canadian French and French and French in Switzerland are different languages. So we use the ISO code. So then there is Canadian So you can label the translation as where it's coming from. I think that is very important.
But I think in this specific situation, probably Alina meant translation that was done in CESDA Dataverse project. And now it's available for public, and it's also published on the Global Dataverse Consortium repository. And you can check it, but it's for old version, for 4.9, I think. So it should be after we'll deliver WebLate and people will start to use it. You probably can extend this translation with new properties, and it will go back to GDC repository.
Yes, then maybe we go, if there are no more questions in the chat, then we can go to the questions from the questionnaire, or the questions you have written down in the last question of the questionnaire, and that's the functionality of Dataverse, and what are the main functionalities of Dataverse, and what are the main difference to other repository tools. So I think that's the perspective. There was one question about multi. I'm sorry. That's the perspective of if you really would like to have a tool like Nestar, I don't think that Dataverse is the right solution, because you don't publish variables and question wordings the same. But yeah, if you put it on in files, it should have almost the same functionality. But Dataverse is a modern system, so we have the kind of what I told you before. We have DOIs, we have linkage to ORCID, we have the possibility to have login using the credentials of your own institute and that kind of information. So, but there will be other systems too that are very good. But yeah, we choose for this one. And we make a report of all the questions of in the chat and of the questionnaires with answers, and we will share that with you. So Slava also put there a link to an evaluation of three different repository services tools. What version of DDI does Dataverse support? At the moment is 2.5, but all variables are stored in separate files. I think these questions are all And there was a question, will we get the slides? Yeah, all the slides and also the recording of this webinar will be shared. And one question about, is, I think it's, no, I'm sorry, I'm looking at the chat and another document at the same time. Something about the layout. Is it possible to customize Dataverse to a specific layout? Yeah, there is a functionality that you can have a home page before it, and you can customize a little bit, not everything, but the home page you can customize to your own needs. But the web the user interface, you can put logos there and you can change it a little bit. But you if you would like to have extra buttons or something like that, that's not possible, or we are not developing that. And then a question of language. I think that we have spoken about metadata. So what the metadata in Dataverse, we will adjust it. But if you would like to adjust the metadata to your own needs, that's also possible for your own installation. And there will be a link where to find the overview of the metadata used in Dataverse. Privacy sensitive data, yeah, we also talked about that. It's not really possible if you have really private sensitive data. I think it's not the most proper solution at the moment, but because Harvard and the Odom Institute are working on a solution, they really would like to have, they are working on a VRE kind of situation where Dataverse is used for publishing the metadata, but the data are stored somewhere else in an enclave in a secure environment. So probably within a year or two or three, this functionality will be available. But at the moment, it's not. And I think for the CESA Cloud, yeah, we I think that this won't be the best solution to put your very privacy sensitive data there. It's always possible to publish the metadata and to have a link to where the data are available. And the lead time of development, I think it was a question of Lars or otherwise, what's the timeline for production or of self-archiving? So at the moment, you already can, in Dataverse CESA project, we have developed a Docker module that allows to build and install Dataverse automatically in the case if an institution decided to run a self-archiving solution. And but if you do that, you still have to make settings like a PID provider and a federated authentication and storage. So you have to do yourself a couple of things. But there is something for self-archiving solution already yet, and you can use it. And what is the time like before features are back in the main branch of Dataverse? Yeah, that's a little bit depending on how Harvard at the moment evaluates this. But what I said before, so the multilinguality, they thought that is very important because otherwise no one from Europe will use that. So yeah, it's a little bit depending on the importance they see, but because like Downs and also I think CESA itself and OSDA are part of the global Dataverse consortium community, we try to if things that we all as a community thinks that's very important, we can ask Harvard to prioritize. Oh, there's still 1 minute, so I don't know. if there are very hot issues we can discuss. Otherwise, we will answer all the questions from the chats written, and we will answer all the questions from the questionnaire, and we will give you a report about that, and also the slides and the recording will be shared. So thank you very much for attending this webinar. Please don't hesitate if you have any questions. And I think I have another slide where our emails are there, and we will answer this as soon as possible. Thank you very much.